Secular job, we had folks that would come in, and you could tell, you know, they were slightly hungover or just a little bit high, but they were able somehow to get to work on time and to function at their job. We had our cookout yesterday, and it seems as though that the saints of God are not functional worshipers. They had this call out today and recover from having a good time. So I think what we'll have to do in the future is have our annual cookout right after morning service.
Amen.
So they can be functionally hungover at work the next day. Yeah, I don't know what it's going to take, but we thank God that you are here. We thank God for those of you that are tuning in later on YouTube. Let's just have a quick word of prayer, and we'll go into what the Lord has for us today. Lord, we thank you so much. You're good.
Yes, yes.
God, we thank you that your love never fails. You always show up, oh God. We thank you, oh God.
Thank you, Lord.
Oh God, for being in the midst even now. Lord, we thank you for the promise that where there are two or three gathered in the midst, you'll be there. And God, you know what we need. We know you know the desires of our hearts. God, I pray that you meet the needs today. Mm-hmm. Fulfill those hearts' desire. In the name of Jesus, save, heal, touch, deliver for your glory. And God, I pray that you till the soil of our hearts that we might receive your word today. Oh God, that we might be better, that we'd be better equipped, well prepared for the days ahead. God, I ask these things in Jesus' name for your glory and your glory alone. Amen.
Amen.
Amen. Amen.
Amen.
Amen.
Amen.
Well, praise the Lord.
Praise the Lord.
God is doing great things, whereof we are glad. Let's turn to Psalms 110. Psalms 110. I have quite a bit of scripture reading today, so we'll read our scriptures and we'll be done. Amen. With just a little commentary sprinkled in between. Praise the Lord. Amen. Psalms 110. Psalms 110. Just the first three verses there for now. The Lord said unto my Lord, sit thou at my right hand until I make thine enemies thy footstool. The Lord said, or the Lord shall send the rod of thy strength out of Zion. Rule thou in the midst of thine enemies. Thy people shall be willing in the day of thy power, in the beauties of holiness from the womb of the morning, thou hast the dew of thy youth. Psalms 110, verses 1 through 3. And if I were to take a topic or a title, it would come from that third verse, get ready for the day of his power.
Amen.
The day of his power is quickly approaching. And it's right here up upon us, and we have to be ready for the day of his power. Amen. And I believe this is a prophetic word for the Lord today and for us here today. God is doing great things, and we've been hearing time and again, this is the year of the turnaround. Things are beginning to change. We're beginning to see change, or at least hear change, and we're still waiting with bated breath for the manifestations to change. Mm-hmm. Yeah, we feel it in the spirit, but what we're seeing with our eyes, our physical eyes, don't always match up what we're kind of sensing and feeling in the spirit realm. We're having a little bit of spiritual vertigo because our eyes and what our eyes are seeing and what our bodies are feeling don't quite line up. But God said, "I'm about to line things up." And the world will see, and the world will know, and it will be indisputable. Here's a vocab word, irrefutable.
Irrefutable.
Now, if I could only say it right, it would be better. Irrefutable, not able to dispute, not able to deny. And that's why I've been saying for about a year now that I believe that the days of the atheist will soon be over.
Amen.
Really, they're over now. But you've got to be able to see that there is a spiritual war going on, not only in our cities, but in our nation and all around the world. It cannot be denied. God wants us to be ready for the day of his power. The very first verse, it says, the Lord said unto my Lord, that's God the Father talking about Jesus. He's talking about the Messiah. Jesus came down to earth. He accomplished everything that the Father wanted him to accomplish. And then God the Father told Jesus, well done, you did it. You did a great job. Now just sit down here at my right hand, cool your heels, until. Sit right here at my right hand until I make thine enemies thy footstool.
Hallelujah.
Jesus got to rest, and he's been resting a long time. I can just imagine him there. I said, I've watched all of Netflix and all the, I've watched everything there is on the internet, and I've drunk all the Kool-Aid and all the drinks, and I'm ready to get up and do something. But no, God is saying, the Father said, no, just sit there and chill a little bit longer. It won't be long now that you'll be get up and to take your rightful position, not only in heaven, but in the earth.
Thank you.
Verse 2, it says, the Lord shall send the rod. Now, the rod is a symbol of authority. The kings would call their rod the diadem. Thy rod and thy staff will comfort me, the psalmist says. He says, and so he says, your authority, the knowledge that I know that you are in control, your authority comforts me. Well, and so does the staff, which corrects me.
Yes.
But his rod and his staff will comfort us. And so the Lord is saying, I will send the rod. And this word actually means branch. He said, I'm going to send a branch, the authority of my strength out of Zion. Mm-hmm. Now, if you know where Zion is, Israel is a nation, and then the capital, right from the Bible day, is Jerusalem, and the world had tried to deny that for so long, even after Israel was reestablished, but thanks God, our last administration helped to reestablish globally the recognition of Jerusalem as the capital of Israel. And then Jerusalem, there's a mountain, Mount Zion, and that's where David, he established his government. And God is saying, he always refers to Mount Zion as the seat of the government of the Lord. This is where Jesus is going to come and rule and reign for the whole earth. He's going to rule from Mount Zion. Mm-hmm. That's his position, where the government of the Lord will be established. And he said, there he'll rule thou in the midst of thine enemies. So all around the world, they'll see. There will come up against Mount Zion. The Bible has prophecies again and again. We hear about the things that are going to go on in the last days. They're going to come up against Mount Zion. They're going to try and defy the armies of God. Now, I don't know exactly when it is. I don't know if it's during a supposed seven-year tribulation, or if it's even at the beginning of the millennium. You read Isaiah 2, and you read Micah 4, and you let me know what you conclude, because it says, in the last days, God will establish his government in the mountains, in Mount Zion. And he said, the enemies of Jesus, the enemies of God, will come up against Mount Zion. And then God's people are going to put a whooping on the rest of the world. That's my interpretation of Isaiah chapter 2. But you can read it for yourself. Amen. So he said, this is what he's going to do. And he said, this is going to happen. And he said, the people shall be willing in the day of thy power, in the beauty of holiness from the womb. So what is he saying? What is all of this saying? So he's saying, the branch, the rod of his authority shall come out of Zion. Zion, as I was starting to say, is where David established his government. But one of the first things, if you remember when David was anointed king three times. He was anointed king by Samuel, and Samuel thought one of the brothers, David's brothers, would or should be king, and so did David's father for that fact. And he came and he said, no, none of these are king material, says God. He said, surely you have another son. He said, well, yeah, we've got another kid out there who takes care of the sheep, but he is not kingly material. He said, well, you know, just for the sake of completeness, let's bring him in here and see. And Samuel said, this is the one. And he anointed him king, and his dad said, okay, now get back out there and tend to those sheep. He was now anointed king, but he's still tending sheep. Then some years later, he was made king of two of the tribes in Hebron. Not all of Israel, they still had a different king. And then years after that, he became king over the whole nation of Israel. And the first thing he wanted to do was not bring abortion back into power, not let all the illegals from all the nations of the earth flood into the country. No, those aren't the first things on his mind. The first thing on his mind was not to sign a law saying that gay marriage should be legalized throughout the nation. No, that wasn't the first thing on his mind. The first thing on his mind, he said, God, we've got to get the Ark of the Covenant back into our country. We've got to get it back here in the seat of authority. And so, you know, he went about, because see what happened was Saul, he knew that the land feared this thing called the Ark of the Covenant or the Ark of God. So when he went into battle, he would take the Ark of the Covenant with him into battle. You know, like a lucky charm. We're surely going to win. And he messed around, fooling around with God, not sincere with God, but trying to make himself big in the eyes of the people. He went out and attacked the Philistines, and they beat him and captured the Ark of the Covenant. That was unimaginable. This is where God dwelled. This is the Holy of Holies. How could the enemies capture it? Mm-hmm. Well, they captured it and they found out they didn't want it. Mm-hmm. It's like trying to grab hold onto a hornet's nest. You'll soon find out you don't want to hug that thing.
Jesus.
And that's kind of what happened to the Philistines. And so David went and tried to get the ark when he became king at first, and he just wanted to get it back home as soon as possible. And he went it. About the procedure incorrectly, and he got a little upset.
Jesus.
He said, you know, I had good intentions. You ever had good intentions about something and it just blows up in your face?
Yeah.
And so, you know, David had a little time of sulking, and they left the ark at Obed-Edom's house, and Obed-Edom was blessed as long as the ark was there.
Yes.
He prospered just because it was there in the presence.
Yes.
You can call that collateral blessing.
Jesus.
Blessing by association. Some of you are blessed just because you've been in a house where mom and dad would pray, where mom and dad would anoint you with oil, where mom and dad would bless the food that you eat, and mom and dad would pray that they would have enough to keep you covered in clothing and keep you protected and healthy. I always say, you know, all my classmates throughout elementary school and middle school, they got so much time off for being sick, but I was never so privileged as to be homesick. Now, I could get up in the morning, Mom, I don't feel well. She said, well, okay, you can get your clothes on, and she'll pat you on the head, I'll anoint you with oil, and get out the door. That never kind of worked, because Dad would always pray. He said, Lord, prevent, shield them from childhood sickness and disease. He always prayed that same prayer. Childhood sickness and disease. All I had was coffee today. I should have had something else. God, protect them from childhood sickness and diseases. All right, we got to find a middle ground here. And so we were prevented. We never had broken bones growing up. We never had ear tubes. Never had any of these dreaded diseases, because we're constantly bathed in that. And that was a collateral blessing. We weren't praying for ourselves. Matter of fact, as soon as we got out the door, we wiped our shiny foreheads off so that the kids would laugh at us. Hallelujah. What's wrong with you? You sweating already? It's 2 degrees outside. No, that's just stuff. My hair grease, that's what it is. Hallelujah. So, David was desiring to get the Ark of the Lord back to Mount Zion. And so he got it straight with the Lord, and he found out, he read back the book of the law, you know, man cannot touch it or handle it, and they had to, or oxen shouldn't handle it. It was designed for a relationship between God and man had to carry it on poles a certain way. And so David said, okay, I'm going to do that. And he said, I forget what it was now, 7 steps, I'm going to make a sacrifice to the Lord. So he got the ark, he lifted it up, they made 6 steps, and they offered a sacrifice to the Lord. They slayed an animal and let the blood be a sacrifice to the Lord. Now, I don't know how many miles it was. Travel was slow as it was, but can you imagine every six steps, on the seventh step, you sacrificed an animal, waited till it burned, worshiped and praised God, then you take six more steps, then the seventh step, do it all over again. I don't know how many days it took David to get to Mount Zion, but when he was getting close, I can just imagine his heart began to skip a beat. Mount Zion was in view, and he began to dance like he was crazy, like he was out of his mind. And his wife was sitting in the castle castle looking at him, saying, look at that. He got that wrinkled shirt on. He's up there making a fool out of himself. He said, when I get him alone, I'm going to tell him about himself. Look, he's supposed to be the king, and he's acting like a fool. And she told him. And David said, you know what? I'm so excited about what the Lord is about to do. He said, you ain't seen nothing yet. I'm about to get even more undignified than this. You see, what David was doing, when in those days, when one army captured another army and king, what they would do is they would parade the defeated king before the army and make them dance all the way back to their home capital to shame him and embarrass him. What David was doing, he was leading the army. He said, the Lord God has captured my heart. Yes, I am a defeated king because I surrendered to the Lord God Jehovah. And I will dance before my Lord. For as long as he will tolerate me to dance before the Lord. He said, I'm going to show them that you rule in the midst of my enemies. You know, what David said, what the branch really is, it's really the ecclesia. There's actually two phases or two stages to the branch or the rod. Number one, we know about in Isaiah 11, verses 1 through 4, this is stage one. And there shall come forth a rod, a branch from the stem of Jesse. We know Jesus comes from the lineage of Jesse, a lineage of David. And it says, the branch shall grow out of his roots. What he's saying there in some translation, it says, out of the stump. If you read the history of the nation of Israel, it was cut down. Like so many churches and people who have proclaimed the name of the Lord, they've been cut down for one reason or another. Their leader has fallen. Or they allowed the cares of the world to infiltrate the church. It became seeker sensitive and not sensitive to the will of God. They shut down because of ordinances of the state, and they don't want to be in trouble. We don't want to go against what our mayor is saying or what our governor is saying. We don't want to be in trouble because if they get us in trouble and they take our building away from them, is this not America? Is this not the land of the free and the home of the brave? We will cease to be free if we so easily surrender our freedom.
Hallelujah.
Hallelujah. It says in Isaiah 11, chapter 1, there shall come forth a rod, a branch out of the stem of Jesse, and a branch shall grow out of the stump, out of the roots. And the Spirit of the Lord shall rest upon him, the Spirit of wisdom and understanding, the Spirit of counsel and might, the Spirit of knowledge and the fear of the Lord. And shall make him of quick understanding in the fear of the Lord. And he shall not judge after the sight of his eyes, neither reprove after the hearing of his ears. But with righteousness shall he judge the poor, and reprove with equity for the meek of the earth. And he shall smite the earth with the rod of his mouth, and with the breath of his lips shall he slay the wicked. This was a prophetic word prophesying about Jesus Christ. But the branch in the Old Testament, it always or often referred to Jesus Christ. But that was only part of the story. In John chapter 15, verses 1 through 8, this is part 2 of the branch. He said, I am the true vine. You see, Jesus graduated. He's no longer the branch. He said, now I'm the vine. And what he said, my Father is the husbandman. Every branch in me that beareth not fruit, he taketh away. And every branch that beareth fruit, he purgeth it, that it may bring forth more fruit. Yeah. Now ye are cleansed by the word which I have spoken unto you. Abide in me, and I in you. As the branch cannot bear fruit of itself, except it abide in the vine. No more can ye, except ye abide in me. I am the vine, you are the branches. Did you get that? Jesus was prophesied all throughout the Old Testament that he was the branch that was coming. He was the branch that was coming. And when that was fulfilled, Jesus said, look, you are the branches. You are the branches that are coming. And so everything that you read about in Isaiah chapter 11, verses 1 through 4, God is saying, it is you, the ecclesia, that the Spirit of the Lord God is resting upon. The Spirit of wisdom and understanding, the Spirit of counsel, the Spirit of might, the Spirit of knowledge and the fear of the Lord. God said, I'm giving it to you because you've got to be able to be ready for the day of his great power.
Jesus.
God says, when Jesus said, when I stand up, everyone needs to be ready. Everyone needs to be in place. I've given you thousands of years to rehearse and get this thing together, church. I've called you to come out and be separated. I called you to be in the world, not of the world. Arise and shine. For your light has come,
yes,
and the glory of the Lord shall be risen upon you.
Jesus.
Hallelujah.
Jesus.
That's stage one and stage two. You're the vine. You're the branches. Verse 6, if a man abide not in me, he is cast forth as a branch and is withered, and men gather them and cast them into the fire, and they are burned. Verse 7, if you abide in me and my words abide in you, ye shall ask what you will, and it shall be done unto you. I know what you've been thinking and what you've been saying. I don't know how it works for you is what you're thinking. But for me, I've asked for a whole lot of stuff.
Yeah.
I pray, okay, almost every day. Well, yeah, you know, when I think about it, two or three times a week at least. And I don't get my prayers answered. I sit down to pray, God, give me wisdom and strength and knowledge and power and bless my cornflakes. Amen. And we wolf down our cornflakes and be on our way. And we expect to be endowed with wisdom and power and strength and might.
Bless him, Lord Jesus.
You're good to have your cornflakes blessed with that kind of prayer. But God said the day is coming that when you ask, I'm putting power and authority in your words.
Amen.
You've got to now get a hold of that tongue. Think about everything that comes out of your mouth.
Jesus.
Because I'm about to pour out my power and my authority upon the ecclesia so that when you ask for something, it's immediately available.
Yes.
Hallelujah. I don't care how quickly Amazon gets something to you, they still won't be able to get it as fast as the Lord God Almighty said, I'm going to answer your prayer. He said, because I put the desire in your heart and I've already sent it before you even asked. Hallelujah. So when you need it, it's right there. Jesus told those that were going out into the midst of the street, in the streets, he said, don't prepare a script.
Yes.
I said, wait a minute, God, I want to get this just right. He said, no, you don't need to get it right. I need to get it right. So you need to be yielded and have your ears pointed toward heaven that you would hear what I'm speaking to you today.
Yes. Yes.
And so as I give it to you, then you give it out.
Yes.
Hallelujah.
Hallelujah.
Get ready for the day of his power. For the day of his power. Verse 3 in Psalms 110, it says again, thy people, the ecclesia, shall be willing. I said, oh God, I pray for that day to come.
Jesus.
If I just had some willing folks.
Yes.
Yes.
Pastor, I'm willing to be there.
Jesus.
But you see, there's a really good show coming on TV and my VCR is broken.
Jesus.
Pastor, I'm willing to be there. Mm-hmm. And in their heart and their mind, they think they're willing to be there. But nothing will stop you. What's in your heart to do if you determine hard enough to do it. God says, in that day, I'm going to raise up some willing folks. I'm going to put a willingness in folks. And they're going to wonder how in the world did I let those excuses stop me from doing what God had called me to do. All of a sudden, their eyes are going to come open and say, God, how in the world did I let those few words that that person spoke to me discourage me so much to stop me from doing what you've commanded me to do. God is going to awaken and stir something up and cause something to rise up into our heart where we'll never be silent again. Hallelujah. God says, in the day, the people shall be willing. They'll spring to action, that word says in the Hebrew. It said, spring into action spontaneously. Before I've had a chance to think about it, all of a sudden I see God working through me. I said, what is it, God? Let me catch up. Hold on. Wait a minute, God. And God said, no, because you've waited. Like Jesus, my son, he's sitting at my right hand right now, and he's waiting. He's waiting, and he's waiting, and he's getting a little bit impatient. So he said, God said, I've got to step up this thing. I've been waiting for my people to get willing, but now I'm going to do it. I'm going to put a willingness in their heart. I'm going to put a deep determination in their heart. I'm going to put a tenacity in them that they will bite into my goodness and not let go. Hallelujah. 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 One day I'll be able to preach. Amen. Glory to God. In the day of thy power, in the beauty of holiness from the womb. What is the womb? The womb is a place of development. The womb is a hidden place. Some of you have been hidden away. Why, oh God, why can I make friends like everybody else? Why is it that they seem to be having such a good time, but whenever I try to step out and have a good time with them, I'm not having a good time? And so I draw back. You're in the womb. God said, I'm protecting you from some stuff. I don't want that carnal mindset to plant itself in your heart and your mind. I want that field to be open and ready for the seeds of willingness, the seeds of devotion, the seeds of determination. Hallelujah. God said, I'm hitting you in the womb. In the womb. In the womb, it says, in the womb of the morning. Now, I've been telling you for a long time. It's a new day. It's a new day. And you know what? In the morning comes, it comes at the beginning of a new day. God says, I'm going to about to release you. You're going to be birthed onto the scene. People are going to say, where on earth did she come from? I thought she was just Miss Mary's son or Miss Mary's daughter. She wasn't Miss Mary's daughter or son. You know what I mean. I thought she was Beth's child. But God said, I'm going to do a quick work. I'm going to do an amazing, miraculous work. I'm going to make you a sign and a wonder in the earth in the last days. You've been hidden from the womb of the morning. Thou hast the dew of thy youth. Some of you, like myself, I realize I'm about the youngest person in here, but some of you, like myself, say, God, I see the setting sun. And I don't know how many years I have left, and I'm not sure that I have as many in front of me as I had behind me. But God said in the last days, he said, I will renew your youth like the eagles. I will restore the dew of your youth. Although your dew has long burned off with the noonday sun, God said, I'm going to restore that dew. I'm going to restore that freshness. I'm going to restore the clarity of mind. I'm going to restore your hearing and ability to hear my voice. Amen. Hallelujah. Amen. Glory to God. How am I doing? Okay. How much time I got left? 5 minutes? That's about all I need. But I might take a few more. Hallelujah. Hallelujah. Right now, this is what God is doing. He's separating. You see, David, when he brought the Ark of the Covenant back, he brought it. I can just imagine David, not even thinking about it. He just wanted it in his place, his seat of authority in Mount Zion. He wasn't really thinking about it. I just want God where I am. I want to be where I am. And I could just imagine the train of priests and the sacrifices going all the way up to Mount Zion. And David is just dancing like a crazy person. And his hair is just flying, headbanging, and doing all kinds of stuff. And he finally gets it there. And then he offers sacrifices to the Lord there in Mount Zion, the Ark of the Covenant, and all the nation can see. They can look up. There was a time when the Ark of the Covenant had to be hidden in the Holy of Holies. You had to come into the gates and then into the courts, and then you had to come into the Holy of Holies, and it was was so holy and so sacred that they, what they would do, only one priest could go in there once a year for all the sins of all of the nations, and they were weren't even certain that he was holy enough to do that task, so they would tie a string around him in case he wasn't in the right position, the right place, the right frame of mind, that God would strike him dead, and so that they couldn't go in and get him because they had died too, so they had to tie a string around him and drag him out. Now we have the Ark of the Covenant out of the Holy of Holies, there in the broad daylight, and people from all around could look up and see the glory of God. But just in view, if you stood up on Mount Zion, you could look down and see the tent of Moses. That's where the gates were. That's where the court was. That's where the holies of holies was. That's where the ark is supposed to be. But God said, what I'm doing in my last day, I'm separating where I am because I want to be with my people. I don't want to be in prison in some place, in some tradition, in some formality, in some form of godliness. God said, I'm separating myself from that foolishness that we see in this day and hour. Somebody told me they walked up and down the street and they were surprised how many churches were closed.
Jesus.
But they found us open. God is separating. God is separating. God is separating.
Hallelujah.
Just because it says church on the outside doesn't mean that God's on the inside. God said, I'm separating my people. I'm separating from those who are pretenders, from those who are serious about seeking and serving me, those who are serious about becoming the ecclesia, those who are serious about ruling and reigning with me. Hallelujah. Hallelujah. Glory to God. Turn with me to Isaiah 25. I'm about through. Through the first 15 minutes of Isaiah 25, verses 6 through 9. And in this mountain shall the Lord of hosts make unto all people a feast of fat things. You know, I was reading this and I had to laugh. And I was at a pastor's prayer emergency session. They called the pastor together to come pray for what was a potential disaster for our nation as Mr. Biden went to the enemies of Israel and sit down with them, and whatever, you know, any kind of foolishness could have happened. And they called us together in the region, and I guess there was about 25, 30 of us together, and we were just to come together, and then they said, you know what, I want you to get up, break up into twos and by twos and twos and pray. And so we did, and I teamed up with the pastor of House of Philadelphia, House of Prayer, and he began to prophesy over me. And he said, the Lord is going to make you fat. I said, well, I'm already there. He said, no, I see the Lord is going to make you fat and prosperous in the both sides and in the front and in the back. I said, in the back too. I don't want people to be saying, baby got back. Anyway, so when I was reading this, I had to laugh. I was thinking about that. And in this mountain shall the Lord of hosts make unto all people a feast of fat things. In other words, what he's saying, I'm going to make a people who will be sitting at the banqueting table, and they will have a feast of plenty. Everything that they need will be there at the banqueting table. You'll be fat, a superabundance, more than you need. That's the kind of God that we serve.
Oh, yes. Oh, yes.
A feast of wines on the lees, of fat things for the marrow, of wines on the lees, well refined. Verse 7, and he will destroy in this mountain, here we go, now I know this is a right now word for the Lord today. It says, the face of the coverings cast over all people, and the veil that is spread over all the nation. He will swallow up death in victory, and the Lord our God will wipe away tears from off all faces. God said he's going to destroy, he's going to take the coverings off his people's faces. Wow, God, did you foresee COVID coming? How they want to put coverings on our faces? And I believe not only on the covering of our faces, it's also a spiritual thing. But the enemy wants to shut us down, to silence us. He doesn't want us to declare with a unified voice. He wants to isolate us and separate us.
Yes,
it's true.
But not only that, I believe we watched a video on Friday night in Kingdom Seeker. If you weren't here, you missed it. I'm sorry. You keep missing it. But maybe one day, God will make a way where there seems to be no way. But this man says he was taken up into heaven, but he said all the revelation, everything he wanted to know was just flooding into his mind. And he felt like he couldn't bear it, couldn't stand it. And the Lord brought him back into his body. And he said he realized then that there was a veil over the whole earth. Because the people are not prepared to receive all the knowledge and all the wisdom that he wants to pour out to them. Even Jesus, when he was with his disciples, he said, there's so many more things I want to tell you, but you're not able to bear them. But God said, in that day, he said he's going to remove the face coverings off the people and the veil that is covering the world. The world can't see God. You really have to strain to see God. You have to put some effort into seeing God, to hearing God, to feeling God. And there's a song that says, even when it doesn't look like he's moving, even when it doesn't seem like he's doing things, he's changing things, God certainly and absolutely is in control.
Yes.
But the day is coming when that veil shall be rent. Mm-hmm. Yes. The Apostle Paul wrote in his day, we see through a glass darkly.
Yes.
We see God doing something and we hear him saying something. Mm-hmm. I don't mean this to be blasphemous, but there was a movie called The Life of Brian, and the crowd was so big and Jesus was given the Beatitudes, and the one guy in the crowd turns to the other and said, what did he say? Mm. He said, I think he said, blessed are the cheesemakers. Mm. And then the other guy said, no, he's really saying that metaphorically. Blessed is any manufacturer of dairy products. Mm. You see, sometimes God is speaking to us. Yeah. And because we have not practiced and not rehearsed and know the heart of God, we misinterpret what God is saying to us.
Yes.
And then we begin to wonder why the cheesemakers are so blessed. But if they knew the heart of Jesus, he would be saying, they would have heard correctly, blessed are the peacemakers. When God the Father opened the heavens after Jesus was baptized, the heavens opened, he said, this is my beloved Son in whom I am well pleased. Some people heard that, but other people said it thundered. It was just a noise. And some people heard nothing.
It's true.
Why? Because they weren't in the place, in the position. God says, get ready for the day of his power.
Yes.
Stay on your knees. I dare you to stay in prayer until you know you've done something. Okay. Stay in your prayer closet until you know God has heard you and God has answered you.
Glory.
You know, I know a lot of people say, you know, I prayed, I just feel like God's not hearing me. I just don't feel like God is around me or he knows what I'm saying. I don't know, maybe it's because of the household I grew up in, but I've always felt that God hears me. Mm-hmm. I don't always hear him. But I know when I pray, he hears me.
Jesus.
God hears you. But we've got to practice hearing God.
Yes.
We've got to stop talking for a minute.
Yes.
Just shut up, please, and let God speak.
Yes.
Let God say what he wants to say.
Yes.
Stop firing these questions. Why me? Why this? Why that? Why the other thing? Stop with all the whys and let me give you some answers on why.
Yes.
Let me show you how to go about it, how to find the answer.
Jesus.
God will always answer your question directly while you're in the prayer closet, but as you go through your day, because you've left it on the altar of heaven, God will show you as you go.
Sure, yeah, you go.
Hallelujah.
Hallelujah. Hallelujah.
Thank you.
Verse 8, he will swallow up death in victory.
Yes.
There's a lot I could say about that, but I won't. I'll go on. And the Lord God will wipe away tears from off all faces.
All right.
And the rebuke of his people shall he take away from off all the earth.
Mm.
For the Lord hath spoken it. There we go.
Thank you, Jesus.
For the Lord hath spoken it. Verse 9. And it shall be said in that day,
yeah,
lo, this is our God. We have waited for him,
mm-hmm,
and he will save us. This is the Lord. We have waited for him.
Waited.
We will be glad and rejoice in his salvation.
Yes.
Can you say that? Have you got frustrated? I ain't going to pray no more. I'm just going to show up in church and look like I've always been looking. I'm just going to give my money, make everyone think nothing's changed, nothing happened. But when I get out of here, I'm going to do what I want to do. I'm just tired. God's not hearing me. God's not answering me. But for those that wait upon the Lord, God said, I've got a great recompense of reward. He said, I am a faithful God. He that cometh to God must believe that he is, and he is a rewarder of them that diligently. You know that means consistently, whether you feel like it or not. When it's hot outside or when it's cold outside. When things are going great and when things are going horribly wrong. Those that diligently seek me. He said, you're going to be the ones that make up the ecclesia. You're going to be the ones that rule and reign in the earth. You are going to be the one that determines the fate of your city, the fate of your nation, and the nations of the earth. Because you waited on me. Because you stayed right there. Like Job, you went through it. He said, all of my appointed time will I wait on the Lord. For my witness is in heaven and my record is on high. I don't have to defend myself anymore. He said, my witness is in heaven. God sees me. God hears me. God knows me.
Hallelujah.
Hallelujah. Deuteronomy 11:21. Give me another 2 minutes. Deuteronomy 11:21. That your days may be multiplied and the days of your children in the land which the Lord swear unto your fathers to give them. As the days of heaven upon earth. The church has been praying from Jesus to this day. Thy kingdom come, thy will be done on earth as it is in heaven. And God says, I'm about to fulfill that. For my people, for my ecclesia, you're about to see heaven come down. You're about to see heaven on earth, the days of heaven on earth. But you've got to get ready for the day of his power. You've got to get ready for the days of heaven on earth. Last scripture, 2 Corinthians 6:2. For he saith, I have heard thee in a time accepted. And in the day of salvation have I secured thee. That means I've satisfied you. Behold, now is the accepted time. Behold, now is the day of salvation. So many didn't make it into the promised land because of the things that they desired in the wilderness. Well, what we got here is pretty good. No need to rock the boat. Let's not upset the apple cart. We'll stay right here. In fact, there were those with Joshua that said, we're going to stay on this side of the river. We've already built houses. But God said, I've got so much more. I've got so much better. He said, I'm not throwing you out of my household. But I want you to have the goodies of goodies. Why stay in the presence of the Lord and experience the fullness of joy when you can come in to my right hand and experience pleasures forevermore?
All right.
What is Jude 24th verse say? Now, unto him that's able to do, no, and now unto him that's able to keep thee and present thee faultless with exceeding joy. God is able to keep you while you wait. God is saying, while you wait and while you pray, I've heard you. I'm able to keep you while you're waiting with exceeding joy. If you'll wait without grumbling, murmuring, and complaining, understand that I have your best interests at heart. Understand that I have everything under control. Understand that nothing shall separate you from the love of God, which is in Christ Jesus. Not heights nor depths, nor principalities nor powers, nor things present nor things to come. Nothing shall be able to separate you from the love of God, which is in Christ Jesus. The first step in getting prepared for the day of his great power. It's to accept Jesus Christ into your heart and let him be the Lord and Savior of your life. You know, there's fake Christ out there. There are all fake ways They might seem good for a little while, but they lead to destruction. The ways of a man might seem right, but the end thereof lead to death. You might have had a good time last night, but you got to pay for it in the morning. But they that wait upon the Lord, they shall mount up on wings of eagle. They shall run and not be weary. They shall walk and not faint. So give Jesus Christ your heart. Say, Father God, come into my heart. Forgive me of my sins. Wash me with the blood of Jesus. And make Jesus the Lord of my life. And then ask the Lord to fill you. Lord, fill me with your precious Holy Ghost. Because I need to accelerate this process. Fill me with your Holy Spirit and give me the gift of speaking in other tongues. In Jesus' name, amen. We just ask, if you be in him and his word is in you, you can ask what you will and it shall be given. If you ask him for salvation, he'll give you. If you ask him to be filled with the Holy Spirit, he'll fill you. If you ask him to speak in other tongues, you will speak with other tongues. This is the day of deliverance. This is the hour of deliverance, and deliverance is taking the land. God bless you. And shalom.